here in the tavern room of Wright Tavern. So this is in the center of downtown Concord. The house was built 1747, and it is a tavern. So it's a public house. It's a place where people gather for food and drink, but it's also a place where committees would gather and have meetings and things like that, important business. It also works very much in tandem with the meeting house just a short distance away. And if you look at the Doolittle engraving of the British Army entering Concord on April 19th, 1775, you can see this structure very clearly still in the same place that it is today. Now, why is this tavern important in the story that we've been talking about in the lead up to the outbreak of war on April 19th, 1775? And this is where the Committee of Safety was meeting. So a little bit about them. Now, in October of 1774, after General Gage had disbanded the colonial legislature, they reconstituted themselves and formed a provincial Congress. And they started to assume really the reins of government in the province of Massachusetts Bay. And they moved their operation out here to Concord in October, and the big Congress was meeting in the meeting house. But as we get into the latter part of the year and into early 1775, and these delegates, who again have assumed the reins of government in Massachusetts, they're even sending letters out to the towns requesting those towns that have yet to submit their property taxes or rates to the royal government to give them instead to Henry Gardiner, who is the treasurer for the provincial Congress. So they're establishing a cash flow. And what's amazing is that this government, which is, you know, semi-legal, it's really on sort of shaky grounds legally, has such wide support of the people. So they actually are getting money coming in and support of the people in towns all across Massachusetts. But now they're like, all right, we have money coming in. Things are looking increasingly hostile. Growing number of British soldiers in Boston. The harbor's still blockaded. And both sides, of course, are rushing to gather arms and ammunition, artillery. That was one of the big items that both sides were desperate to secure. So they formed what was called the Committee of Safety, and they are spearheading the military buildup. So stockpiling the arms, determining where they're getting them from, where they're being stored. Concord, of course, was one of the major magazines or supply depots, but there were many towns that were involved in the effort. And you know, they're overseeing the reorganization of the militia, and really putting them on a warlike footing, getting ready for the coming conflict against the British Army, their own army, that would, of course, occur in April of 1775. And this is where they're meeting, here in Wright Tavern. So this is very much the place where all of these preparations are being made and all these plans are being made. Joel, now you've done a lot of research on the Committee of Safety. So what can you tell us about sort of the extent of their operation?
Well, it's great to be in this building where they made all these decisions. But the Committee of Safety had another subcommittee called the Committee of Supplies. Mm-hmm. And they were the ones who made the decisions on what they were going to purchase. And then they had Colonel James Barrett, Captain Jonas Haywood of Concord. Mm-hmm. They worked for the Committee of Supplies, and they were the ones in charge of carrying out all the orders, right, where things were going to be. There were supplies stockpiled all over town, including Barrett's house, which, yes, we're going to visit soon. And the decisions that were being made here were extremely important. They knew the British were coming, mm-hmm, at some point, and you can see in the minutes where they discuss moving things around. These cannon are going to go to Stowe. These ones will go back to Concord. You know, so many canteens. There were 15,000 canteens stored up from Potter's house. And how many of them were going to be moved around so if the British came, they couldn't get them all? I don't think they had enough time once they made their decisions here, mm-hmm, to carry it all out. Obviously, some were moved, but right, some of the supplies were still here when the British came in.
Now, they were looking to raise an army of observation. I mean, what is this? How large is it?
Well, army of observation, they were talking about having roughly 15,000 men, you know, and it's funny that they have this army of observation to watch what's going on at the same time that they're building all these supplies up, yeah, to inevitably go to war.
I mean, that's treason. I mean, plain and simple.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and drafting the rules and regulations for the Massachusetts
rules
Army.
Rules and regulations were drafted right next door. Yep. Yeah, that's a huge thing. Yeah. They were drafted April 5th is when they sat down and put it all together. It took a little while, and they were printed on May 3rd, 1775, for issue to the Army.
Yeah, drafted really 2 weeks before they went to war.
Before they went to war.
Yeah, so they're really getting ready. They know it's coming.
It's happening,
Just an incredible effort. You know, and one of the things that struck me, you know, like one of the iconic images we have of April 19th is Paul Revere riding through the night, the signal lanterns, one up by land, two up by sea. You know, but if you look in the minutes of the Committee of Safety, they're talking about setting that up, about having riders that are going to go out to the principal magazines, including Concord, and alerting Colonel Barrett, you know, who's supposed to keep teams of men and oxen in readiness to move these supplies if they get word from you know, from committee members in Charlestown.
You have to think about, too, is when they got the word, you know, there's a note that goes to John Hancock from Elbridge Gerry, a member of the committee, and it's saying that the British officers are on a patrol and they know, you know, this is, we ought to be serious, is what it says. And Hancock responds back, I'll send word to Concord. And so that's at 9 o'clock at night on the 18th. And Barrett and Haywood and many of the others that ran the teams had a Herculean effort to try and get as many supplies out of town as they could before the British arrived that morning. You think about it, those men were up all night long moving supplies, hoping to make sure that as little as possible was destroyed by the British.
And of course, as we know, when the British did arrive on this search and destroy mission, they found some things and destroyed some things, but a lot of it.
A lot of it they didn't, and you know, if you look at Gage's list that he had from the spies in Concord, they were sending information out. Not all of the locations of her supplies are listed. Ebenezer Hubbard on the other side of the mill pond from this structure had flour, which they had found. They got some cannon shot and musket balls from the courthouse. They burned some cannon carriages that had been built for the use of the field artillery, but they really didn't get a whole lot, and a lot of that is because of how well the committee worked.